ThinkTech Hawaii. Civil engagement lives here.
Hey, aloha, and welcome to Stan the Energy Man this week on Friday the 13th, but I'm not nervous. What could possibly go wrong? I've got a great guest this week, and I'll introduce him in a second, but before I do, my guest and I both attended a great event on Wednesday. We are hosted by Servco Pacific out at their Mapunapuna grand opening of the very first publicly available hydrogen fueling station in the state of Hawaii, and that is a true game changer for the state of Hawaii. It's the very first one. Servco and Toyota brought in the vehicles, so we have Toyota fuel cell vehicles on island. We have a commercial station on island, and there's a whole lot of other hydrogen stuff going on in the state of Hawaii that we're going to talk about today. And the reason we're going to talk about hydrogen today, besides it's one of my favorite subjects, is it's also one of my guests' favorite subjects. And so I'm glad to invite to have as a guest today Representative Mark Nakashima from the Big Island, from Hilo, who's also the vice chair of the state legislature, the House of Representatives,
and
vice speaker of the House in Hawaii, in the state legislature. Mm-hmm. And he's a big hydrogen fan, just like I am. And in fact, the first time I met him, he started talking hydrogen before I even knew what hydrogen was. And he's really, really a great advocate for renewable energy, clean energy, sustainable energy. And especially for the Big Island. So welcome, Rep, and it's great to have you on. And I know we have plenty to talk about. So why don't you start off by talking about maybe some of the legislation that you've seen lately that you think is gonna be coming up in the next session that we ought to be looking for?
Well, you know, Stan, I think that, you know, hydrogen has been something that for me has been really important issue. You know, living on the Big Island, you know, we see all of the different renewable energy opportunities and vehicles that are coming before us, and you know, with the plug-in electrics and the hybrids. You know, my concern there was that the range on those vehicles really weren't up to the Big Island standards in terms of the distances that we needed to cover. You know, if I get into my car, I know I'm going to do at least 100 miles that day. And because of that, you know, I was looking for something that could accomplish that on the Big Island. And when I learned about the hydrogen fuel cell vehicle, you know, that really excited me. And I think, you know, for, you know, the 10 years I've been in office, you know, that is something that I've really been pushing for and trying to see move ahead. I think that the technology is finally catching up with us, that, you know, we're able to kind of realize some of those dreams. And so I'm really excited about looking forward and the opportunities that this first hydrogen station that's open to the public here on Oahu, the availability of hydrogen fuel cell vehicles to the consumers locally is really exciting. And I think that, you know, in order to support those kinds of things, we are continuing to look at our investment as a state into the hydrogen infrastructure, into changing some of the laws that will be much more inclusive of the hydrogen fuel cell vehicle in our procurement and our purchasing plans, and also looking at ways to help meet our energy goals, not only for electricity, but also now that the mayors have put it out there for motor vehicles as well, that, you know, we have lots of things that we can look forward to working on this year and in the coming years.
Great. Yeah, we don't call it the Big Island for nothing, right?
Yeah, that's right.
And not only do we have the distances, but you also have some mountains to climb. Even if you go on the Saddle Road, you're going up a couple thousand feet. And then down the other side, it's a challenge for any electric vehicle, including a hydrogen fuel cell vehicle. It takes more energy to go up hills with electric vehicles. So
Definitely. It's
good to have the range.
Yeah, and you know, my district's unique in that you know, I can go from sea level to 13,000 feet in a matter of an hour and 15 minutes. So, you know, there's nowhere else in the world where you can make that kind of elevation right. in that short period of time. And so, you know, those do present challenges to any motor vehicle. And I think that, you know, hydrogen is one of the vehicles that are going to be up to snuff to be able to do that.
Well, the Big Island's slated to get three vehicles right now, two for the National Park Service and one for the Halion bus, that are being done by the University of Hawaii, HNEI, Mitch Ewan and his folks.
Right.
And they're getting ready to be delivered. And Mitch's station, as I understand it, is nearing completion and probably should be up and running within the next 30 days, I would say, based on, you know, what I've seen of his timelines. And I know we're all excited about that because the Big Island is always been anticipating these things, but the bad news is we got the volcano kicking off and closing down Volcano National Park, so we may have to push those vehicles into the Halion bus system too and get all three of them running in that system.
You know, I think you know, regardless of where they end up, you know, that they will end up on the Big Island, I think is kind of key to beginning that realization of the dream that, you know, we'll have this alternative energy source on island. You know, I think for years we were waiting for other hosts for this hydrogen fueling station, which really delayed us year after year. And, you know, it has been, you know, 10 years in the making, you know, as we were waiting for this to finally happen. And, you know, groundbreaking had occurred. The buildings are up, the electrolyzer is in place, and so now it's a matter of just going through the final phases of testing to make sure that everything's connected up correctly. And then all we need are the buses to be brought on over so we can start running them.
It's kind of ironic, too, that Mitch worked so hard for that electrolyzer to be built at Puna Geothermal. And if it had been, we'd have been at a stopping point again. It was built there, but it's being built out at Nelha over on the Kona side, which meant the Halion bus route changed a little bit, but it'll at least be running out there because of the hydrogen's in a protected area. It's going to be good to go.
Yeah, so, and I think that, you know, I'm glad that, you know, that decision was finally made to put it up at Nelha in West Hawaii. Although it's not ideal, it is in the ground. We are ready to go on that, and I'm hoping that as we move forward on that project and expand that project a little bit more, then, you know, other dreams of you know, having a airport shuttle service provided by hydrogen fuel cell vehicles running in the Kona Airport. Also, you're making available at some point hydrogen fuel cell rental vehicles for the driving public to kind of get used to and familiar with hydrogen fuel cell vehicles and realize that, you know, it's just like driving a regular gasoline car.
And that's a great way to pitch it to the rental car companies because a lot of people, even local people, will go to the rental car and rent a car they're thinking about buying. You know what I mean? So, so if you're curious about hydrogen fuel cell vehicles, one of the best places to go and check it out, and not just drive it down the street at a dealer, but really put it through its paces, is to go rent it for a weekend on the Big Island and go drive around and see what it's like going up the hills and everything. So it's a great way to check out a vehicle like that.
Definitely. You know, I think that if you're, you know, given that opportunity to test drive it, especially on the Big Island with all of the different conditions that you can face, you know, will provide you with a very good idea of what the capabilities of the vehicle are, and the fact that it can meet and exceed many of the conceptions or the expectations that you may have for a hydrogen fuel cell vehicle.
Well, I think you're lucky too that on the Big Island you got a lot of high-speed cheerleaders for hydrogen already built in between Blue Planet being there.
Yes. Chauncey
and the guys at DOT Airports in Kona are probably the biggest hydrogen fans in all of state DOT that I've ever found anyway.
Yes,
and they would
yes.
love to see. They've already got roads designated where the vehicles are going to go. I mean, they're leaning so far forward that Ford had to pull them back a couple years ago to say not right yet. But there's a lot of enthusiasm for hydrogen on the Big Island, so we're looking forward to seeing some of these projects pick up. But what if you could paint a picture of the Big Island like 10 years from now, what would it look like with hydrogen?
You know, I think if I could paint a picture, you know, very early on we looked at what the needs really would be for the Big Island. I think that what we came up with was an idea that if we had five stations strategically placed around the island, then you know you could easily make it around the island to any point that you wanted to, and not have to worry about whether or not you were going to run out of gas, so to speak. And I think, you know, ideally, if we could see those five stations realized around the island, I think we saw one in West Hawaii, one in East Hawaii, one in the Kamuela area up in Kona, one down in Kau, and something in between to allow for getting around the island. That would more than meet the feeling needs of a person who wanted to go anywhere around the island. You know, with the projected range of about 312 miles, you know, there's nowhere on the island you couldn't go. Now, we don't have four-wheel drive fuel cell vehicles yet, but you know, that's something that we'll be hoping for one day. But in the meanwhile, as far as highway driving's going, you know, I think if we had five stations around the island, then you know, you could more than satisfy the driving public.
Well, if you want to look at a really cool four-wheel drive tactical type vehicle, there's a company called Nikola Motors, and they are specializing in 18-wheeler trucks, but they also have a quad. And the folks who own that company, the patriarch, has a place on Maui.
Oh, really?
And they're going to bring that vehicle over to Hawaii sometime, and we'll make sure you get a look at that thing.
It's got a lot of
horsepower, and it would be just awesome off-road. But, you know, I was thinking that when I went to Surfco this week with you at that opening ceremony, one thing that really impressed me and surprised me was their advertising that Mirai will get 300 to 312 miles on a fill-up of hydrogen. But some of the folks there, now that their station has been up and they've been actually driving the cars and using the hydrogen at the station, they've been tracking the mileage. And they're predicting that they're going to get closer to 350, maybe even 400 miles per fill-up.
Wow.
So it's actually getting better mileage than they anticipated, which is not uncommon, because a lot of times when the engineers predict what the ranges are going to be, they use real conservative numbers. So I'm really excited that the cars are actually getting better range than initially predicted. And I think that's going to, if it keeps consistently doing that, it's going to be a real selling point for those vehicles, I'm sure.
Well, you know, I think the upside for most people, especially given a lot of the freeway traffic that you get here on Oahu, is that, you know, when your gas is off the accelerator, you're not burning anything, right?
Right.
So, you know, there's not even an idling of gas being wasted. So, you know, I think that, you know, the fuel cell offers all of those great options. You know, your exhaust is water, so you know you're not adding to any pollution. Right now, you know, if we electrolyze that water using solar energy, then you know it's
a totally carbon-free
process. And so that I think is really what is exciting. The fact that we have all of the resources locally to make our own hydrogen here is also to me a really big game changer. Because of the fact that I think our biggest import from Hawaii is money, the money that we use to pay for fossil fuels
we're bringing in.
And so if we can make our own energy source here, that money stays right here in our
economy. That's the whole point. And I've said this many, many times from day one. People really don't understand the impact of spending money to buy fossil fuels. The impact to our local economy is gigantic. And I've tried to get Mr. Brubaker, one of our state's economists, you know, to or Eugene from DBED, our economist there, to help me articulate it the right way in numbers. And I can't quite get them there, but it's just, it's got to be phenomenal. The amount of, if all that money stayed in the state and went into producing our own hydrogen and making jobs here, and then people are paying taxes on and buying houses and buying goods, now you just, it's like turbocharging your economy to go from an energy importing economy to an energy neutral or maybe even energy exporting. I mean, we have a lot more energy available to us than we can use. The problem is here on Oahu, we have more use than production, but we're the bad boys on the market. Maui and the Big Island, they can produce a lot more energy than they need, big time, by multiples. And they could even be exporting energy to Honolulu or exporting it to California, to Asia, if they really wanted to. Mm-hmm. So there's an opportunity for that. We're going to take a quick break here, a little bit early maybe, and get back with Rep. Nakashima and maybe talk a little bit about how hydrogen could be used on the grid on the Big Island.
And aloha, my name is Calvin Griffin, the host of Hawaii in Uniform. And every Friday at 11 o'clock here on ThinkTech Hawaii, we bring you the latest in what's happening within the military community. And we also invite all your response to things that's happening here. For those of you who haven't seen the program before, again, we invite your participation. We're here to give information, not disinformation. And we always enjoy a response from the public. But join us here, Hawaii in Uniform, Fridays, 11 a.m., here on ThinkTech Hawaii. Aloha.
Hi, everyone. I'm Andrea Gabrielli. I'm the host for Young Talents Making Way here on ThinkTech Hawaii. We talk every Tuesday at 11 a.m. about things that matters to tech, matter to science, to the people of Hawaii, with some extraordinary guests, the students of our schools who are participating in Science Fair. So Young Talents Making Way every Tuesday at 11 a.m. only on ThinkTech Hawaii. Mahalo.
Hey, welcome back to Stan the Energy Man on my lunch hour here at ThinkTech Hawaii on Friday the 13th. And Rep. Nakashima, great to have you on board here. We've been talking hydrogen for at least 5 years. You've been talking a lot longer than me, but that's when I started talking to you about it.
Yes.
But let's talk a little bit about what Helco might look at, because you do produce an awful lot of your energy already off of renewables. Including geothermal, mm-hmm. When it's up and running, it put out about 20% of the power
about
when it's 30%, running.
30%, I 30. Think, yeah.
And then you also have hydroelectric, which is also renewable. So you have two forms of renewable energy there that aren't intermittent renewable. They're not solar and wind, so they're much better for your utility to have to work with in terms of stabilizing your grid.
Right.
So it's much more of their traditional power generation that they're used to dealing with. Mm-hmm. So you have the luxury of being renewable without being intermittent renewable, and can go much further than Hawaiian Electric here on Oahu can with renewable energy, because you have the geothermal and you have hydroelectric too. I remember going to visit Richard Haas' farm with you a long time ago,
right.
And he had his own little hydroelectric plant.
That's right.
Right off of his, on his farm, that I forget how much it put out, but you know, he could probably provide a whole neighborhood power just off of that little hydroelectric thing. And yes. He didn't even need to get a special permit, because he was using the old sugar flumes.
Right.
I think the only permit he had to get was to discharge the same water he just took out back into the stream, and that mm-hmm. was it. And that's the kind of stuff that's available to you on the Big Island. But in terms of energy storage, last week and I think a couple of weeks ago, I showed a graph, and I do whenever I brief this stuff, that battery storage on the grid starts to hit a wall when you get to a real high kilowatts, or you get to a long duration.
Right.
And so we do talk about hydrogen for energy storage on the grid. Have you been talking to Helco about that possibility on the Big Island?
I have not spoken to Helco per se about the use of hydrogen fuel cells or the storage of hydrogen. However, a couple of years ago, I did make an effort as I was trying to kickstart this hydrogen economy to go to different alternative energy folks on the Big Island. I went to the folks that have the windmills up in North mm-hmm. Kohala. I went to the folks that were doing the hydroelectric and talked to them about the possibility of making hydrogen using the electrolysis 24/7 whenever they had the power, storing that hydrogen and then using that as your fuel source to provide the electricity to provide electricity back into the grid.
Okay.
And then you convert this intermittent power to base power because now you have a source of your energy, which is the hydrogen. You control it. It's not dependent on whether the wind is blowing or whether the sun is up. And you burn it when you want to. So it becomes a good source of base power. You turn solar energy and wind energy
into a base load power
in that way. And I think the fluctuations in the price of gas, have kind of really determined whether or not that becomes something economically feasible or not. And so when we were in 2009, 2010, and the price of gasoline was headed toward $4, everybody was going to go nuts, and they were looking for many alternatives. When the price went down, that pressure kind of went away. But I think that it's already back at $4 again now.
So
next time it's going to go to $6.
Right.
And then we'll be spurred again to look at these alternatives. I think that we should do that now before it gets to $6, because once you get there, it's already too late.
Yeah, one of my theories in life is you don't want to be looking for a lawyer or a doctor when you need one. You want to do that ahead of time so that when you need one, you already know who you're going to go to.
Exactly.
And I think it's the same with hydrogen. We shouldn't be sitting here putting it off and then waiting until gas is at $6.50 a gallon or $7 a gallon and screaming and then saying, well, we could have built the infrastructure and had hydrogen available, but we didn't want to do it back when gas was $4 a gallon.
Right.
So we need to be working on that now. I agree with you wholeheartedly. And I think that's a good challenge for this legislature. What are some of the things you think we can do this legislative session coming up? We have time now to maybe help modify some of the old statutes or maybe introduce some new statutes. What are some of the things you think we should be working on this session?
Well, I think that one of the things that we do need to look at is to look at our procurement laws. Right now, the procurement law treats hydrogen fuel cell vehicles differently from other electric vehicles. And so one of the things that I think is important is that we erase that distinction and say, realize that a hydrogen fuel cell vehicle is an electric vehicle and, kind of move forward from there. Other things I think we need to look at is, again, going back to our state needs and the state infrastructure, the hydrogen fuel cell platform really is much more practical when you use it on large vehicles like buses.
Right.
And so, if we can turn some of our bus fleet not only at the municipal level, but at the state level, at the airports, and if we can turn our bus fleets into hydrogen fuel cell vehicles, then that's a much very practical use of the hydrogen fuel cell technology to promote it, to make people realize that it's here around us and that it does work.
Well, I know that Ford Fujikami moved up from DOT director up to the governor's office as a special advisor. But he started a test program out at the airport with the airport shuttles, the rental car shuttles. And this September, Hawaiian Electric, Hawaii Gas, and HCAT, in partnership with US Hybrid, are bringing out alternative fuel vehicles to run in that program. So Hawaiian Electric is going to run electric vehicle. Hawaii Gas is going to run a natural gas vehicle, mm-hmm. and HCAT US Hybrid are going to run a fuel cell vehicle. And we're in the final stages of meeting that contract. The vehicles start arriving in the middle of next month and getting all their wraps on and their safety checks and their PUC certifications and all that stuff and get the driver training in. And 1 September, those vehicles are supposed to start rolling. So hats off to Ford for his efforts. And I know for a fact, after talking to the governor on Wednesday, because he was at that ceremony too, mm-hmm. he's excited. And he's also a pretty good hydrogen cheerleader, I think. He always smiles when he sees me, and it amazes me he remembers my name because he meets so many people. And I don't see him very often, but he still knows who I am.
Oh, yeah, the governor's very much a techie.
Yeah.
And I think that the times that I've seen him most excited is when he's talking about, you know, the advances in technology,
yeah.
and the opportunities that are offered to the state of Hawaii when we look at the different types of technology. And so, you know, I think that the fact that we're having this demonstration at the airport is key as we look forward to, you know, what platforms are available to us. How they work out in the real world, and then how we might employ them into the future.
Yeah, and I think it's all of those things, the governor's excitement, the standing up of the station by Servco, the initiatives that you've made, you know, push forward, and the laws that Hawaii has brought on board to push hydrogen into the forefront. It's starting to pay off because on the average, once a week, I end up talking to some international company or some mainland company that has hydrogen equipment or fuel. I mean, and these aren't little companies. One of them was Show Oil. That was about 3 weeks ago. And Hitachi, who's doing some innovative work with hydrogen from aerobic digesters mm-hmm. with, I mean, you think Hitachi. They're working with industrial waste products from wastewater treatment plants mm-hmm. to make energy. You know, these companies call us and say, can you put me in contact with some folks out in Hawaii because we're interested in becoming involved in this? Even Department of Energy has listed us as one of the top 10 states in the U.S. to work with hydrogen. And in fact, when I talk to them personally, they say right behind California, we're number 2. And it's nice to see Hawaii in the top 2, especially in hydrogen. So I know a lot of that credit has to go to you. You've been pushing that bubble a lot longer than I have, and I appreciate it. But we got about 30 seconds left. You have any great last words for the folks here?
Well, you know, I think that the opportunity that, you know, the opportunity has been a long time coming. And one of the things I want to do is make sure that we don't squander this opportunity, that we make use of the fact that, you know, Hawaii is going to be one of the first markets that has a hydrogen fuel cell vehicle available. I'm looking forward to hopefully being one of the first owners of a fuel cell vehicle once the Mirai becomes
available
mm-hmm. not only on the Big Island, but you know, the first sales actually happened here on Oahu. You know, I'd be looking forward to all of that, and I think that all of those things are very exciting, and I hope that this is just the beginning of good things to come.
I agree. Well, thanks for joining us again today, okay. Rep.
Thank you.
Now that you've moved up the food chain in the legislature, we're looking for even more horsepower up there. Thanks, everyone, for joining us this week, and thanks to Cindy and Robert here in the studios for making all the magic happen. And we'll see you next week, Friday, on Stan the Energy Man. Aloha.